My dear students, in this class of HS first year, we were discussing theme 1 titled From the Beginning of Time, and today we shall discuss part 4 of it, and today I hope we shall complete our discussion over this particular theme, that is the theme 1. So today we shall discuss From the Beginning of Time part 4. The first point that we shall discuss is early humans making tools. In my last class I have told you that whenever human beings started bipedalism, their hands became free of the purpose of walking, and from that time onwards they perhaps started using tools by hands for different purposes, mainly for hunting. Most probably the earliest stone tool makers were the Australopithecus. It was since the time of the Australopithecus, the early men started making tools. The earliest evidence for the making and using of tools are found in Ethiopia and Kenya in Africa. Most probably, men and women, both the groups in the human society, produced and used tools. At first, tools were made of stone. First of all, they started using raw stones for the purpose of hunting. Then somehow they discovered that the stones which have sharp ends or sharp edges work better for the purpose of hunting, and after that they started making the stones sharper by rubbing on another stone, and in this way perhaps the tool making began. The earliest tools were the choppers, hand digs, hammer stones, other cutting tools which are found at Olduvai dated 2.6 million years ago. About 35,000 years ago, some improvements came in respect of tool making. Some more developed tools began to be produced. For example, the spear thrower, bow and arrow, etc. The early men used to obtain meat from the body of the animals, and they started processing meat by drying, smoking, storage, etc., for which tools were needed. Therefore, from that purpose, for that purpose also, they started making different tools. For example, tools like chopper, which used to chop meat, were being used, which were produced from stone. They produced traps for catching fur-bearing animals. They used the skins of the fur-bearing animals at the time of winter, because at the time of winter, in order to get relief from cold, they used to cover their bodies with the skin of the fur-bearing animals. Fur was thus used to cover body as protection from cold. So they started to produce traps for catching fur-bearing animals. The evidence of sewn clothing came from about 21,000 years ago. Clothing was done with the skins of animals. They had no idea of producing cloth of themselves, and they used skins of the animals as clothes. There took place the introduction of the punch blade and small chisel-like tools. It enabled early men to engrave designs on the handles of the tools which they produced, made of bone, antler, ivory or wood, any other things. So here in this picture, you can see in image number one, a man with bow and arrow. This is a tool or a weapon which the man is using for hunting. In picture number two, we had the pictures of hand axe. Axe was used for cutting trees as well as for cutting meat from the body of the animal, and also a picture of spear. In picture number three, we may see the pictures of chisels, which with they used to engrave designs on the handle of the weapons or tools. In picture number four, we have a picture of a spear. In picture number five, we have the images of punch blade with which they used to chop meat from the body of the animals. And in picture number six, we get the tools for digging soil. So these were the common tools which they used at the beginning. Now in picture number seven, we get a little bit developed tool, that is a spear thrower. And in picture number eight, we get two pictures. One is the process of tool making. You carefully notice how the tool is being made from a piece of stone. And picture B is an engraved bone tool, a tool the handle of which is engraved. This particular picture is again shown in picture number 9, and there you may notice a body of horse is engraved on the handle of a tool. Most probably the handle is made of a bone of any big animal. Here is a picture where the early men are making tools. You may see both men and women together. They are sitting and making tools with many other articles like stones and other things are also there in their hands. Another important point we have to discuss is the modes of communication. Now gradually human societies developed a sort of communication or language among themselves. There were two modes of communication that the early men had, namely first language and second art. We shall discuss each of the points separately. Language. Among living beings, humans alone have language. If you see the entire animal world, including human, you may see that no animal except human has language. They have their calls or sounds of their own, but no animal other than human has language. Because in order to speak with language, an animal needs first of all a vocal cord, which only the human being is having, no other animal is having. Perhaps language evolved through the following few stages. First, it was the hominids who evolved communication through gesture and hand movements. When the early men were in the stage of hominids, they used to communicate each other through gestures and hand movements. In the second stage, in the next stage was the non-verbal communication, such as singing or humming started. In the next stage, there started the non-verbal communication. No sentence or word was used. Only through singing and humming, they used to communicate with each other. In the third stage, human speech probably began with the calls that have been observed among the primates. If you observe the primates, for example, chimpanzee or a big monkeys, you may observe that they have a call, particular sound which they make through their mouth, and they understand themselves the meaning of the sounds. These sounds are called the calls of the primates. So human being speech also began probably as the calls that the primates have. In the initial stage, humans might have possessed a small number of speech sounds, and thus they developed a few speech sounds at first. Gradually, these might have developed into language, and from these speech sounds, gradually language developed. One more thing is very much attached to the development of language, and that is the following. Development of language is closely related to the development of vocal cord in the human body. When vocal cord originated in the human body, within the throat of the human being, they started speaking in language. Perhaps the brain of Homo habilis had developed certain features which indicate that they had evolved language around 2 million years ago. The vocal cord of humans originated around 2 lakh years ago. At first, the vocal cord of human being originated around 2 lakh years ago, and it was perhaps at the stage of Homo habilis, because the brain of Homo habilis had developed certain features which indicate that they had a language of their own. According to another view, language evolved among the humans around the same time as art, that is about 40,000 to 35,000 years ago. And when we shall discuss the point art, then you will be able to understand this better. Art. Early humans developed art. They had developed art at the very early stage, because we had already seen that they started engraving the designs, various designs on the handles of the tools. So they had developed a sort of art. Hundreds of paintings were done by them on the walls of the caves in which they lived. These may be dated fairly in between 30,000 to 12,000 years ago. Three of such important cave shelters are Lascaux and Chauvet in France. Another is in Altamira in Spain. These are three important cave shelters where the cave paintings are found. Even in India also, there is a place, there is a cave named Bhimbetka. There also, in central province, there also we may get the cave paintings by the early men. The pictures included the depictions of animals mainly. In the pictures, there were the pictures of the animals mainly, like bison, horse, ibex, deer, mammoths, rhinos, lions, bears, panther, hyenas, etc. paintings on gables perhaps were done not only for the sake of art, but it had some other purposes. Paintings of animals were associated with rituals and magics. Now, most probably, paintings were done not only for the purpose of art, but it was related to some rituals and magics, which is again related to hunting. The act of painting could have been a ritual to ensure a successful hunt. Whenever a group was ready to go out for hunting, before that they used to draw the pictures of the animals which they want to hunt. Then they used to chant some mantras of their own so that they could hunt the animals successfully. It was their belief that if they did like this, then the hunting would be successful. They had a belief like that. So most probably the painting was done for that purpose also. From that angle also, they used to draw the pictures of the animals and those animals which were usually hunted by them. So this is an explanation is given by the social scientists behind the painting habit of the early man. Another explanation is there in respect of painting on cave walls by early humans. Probably these caves were the meeting places for small groups of people or locations for group activities. Now, in these caves where the early men used to live, the people of the group, they used to meet with each other. Some other groups also sometimes used to come and join. These groups could share hunting techniques and knowledge with each other. While paintings and engravings served as the media for passing information from one generation to another, there, teaching was being done about hunting. The techniques and knowledge of hunting were exchanged by the old generation to the new generation, by one group to another group, and the mode of communication or language was painting or engraving, because at that stage, language did not develop in full form, or a group may not understand the language of the another group. So through painting, the entire discussion was made and the idea was exchanged from one group to another group or one generation to another generation. In this way, painting developed in the different caves. So in this picture, in image one, there is a picture of group hunting. The people, they are chasing two or three deers with spears in their hands. In image two, this is a picture of a bison, which were usually hunted by the early men, and the picture is found in the Cave of Altamira, about the Cave of Altamira we have just now referred in our lecture. In image number 3, the pictures of horses are there. Horses were also hunted by the early men. In picture number 4, it is a different picture, a picture of group encounter. Two groups of human societies are fighting with each other with the weapons, most probably to establish control over the another group. This is a picture of group encounter. The present hunter-gatherer societies, group encounters. Now we shall discuss what were the group encounters or how were the group encounters. In the present world, there are a few hunter-gatherer societies who still live on hunting and gathering basically. In the modern world also, there are, although in few number, hunter-gatherer societies who live on hunting and gathering till the modern age. They are the subject of observation by the anthropologist. Now, I hope you know about the subject anthropology. Anthropology is a subject which studies the different human societies. So, anthropologists, they observe the behaviors of the hunter-gatherer societies of the modern age, and from their behavior, they try to understand the hunter-gatherer societies of the age of the early man. Sometimes, different groups became involved in encounter with each other. This is known from observing the behaviors of the hunter-gatherer societies of the present day. Nowadays also hunter-gatherer societies who are, although in a very few in number, they used to involve in encounter with each other. From this, it can be guessed that in the age of the early man also, the hunter-gatherer societies became involved in encounters with each other to establish control over the another group. And already we had seen such a picture in a cave painting. Kunsan is one such society who live in the Kalahari Desert in Africa. They established control over another hunter-gatherer society in 1870 without bloodshed, and the event is narrated nicely. One person from a hunter-gatherer society of Kalahari Desert in Africa named Kunsan, he had narrated a story that how they had established in 1870 their control over another hunter-gatherer society. If you go through the book, this particular chapter, in this particular section, you may get the story nicely. It is written and it is in page number 23. We may get pictures of such encounters in cave painting also, and we had seen it just now. Another hunter-gatherer society is the Hadja. They are a small community who live in the savanna region in the vicinity of Lake Eyasi in Africa. Savanna is a grassy land. It is a land of grass. The grassy land is full of thorn and bush and full of grass-eating animals like buffaloes, giraffe, rhinos, zebras, etc., which are hunted by the Hadjas. They also take vegetables which are wildly grown in that region. They do not know to cultivate vegetables which are widely available. These are taken by the Hadjas, as well as honey, which is also naturally available. They also do not know the cultivation of honey of themselves. They used to shift their camps season wise and never assert their permanent rights on land they once occupied. And they used to shift their camps. They are not the permanent settlers. They used to shift their camps season wise, and they had no idea of permanent occupation of land. So about the Hadjas in details, you can get the entire picture from page number 24 of your book. Go through it once. Hunter-gatherer societies from present to past. Anthropology studies the modern hunter-gatherer societies to get a knowledge of the hunter-gatherer societies of the past. That this point is I have discussed already. Such study is known as ethnography, which means the study of contemporary ethnic group. Remember the name ethnography, which means the study of contemporary ethnic group. They used to study the modern hunter-gatherer societies to get knowledge about the past hunter-gatherer societies. And this particular study is known as ethnography. Some scholars suggest that the present hunter-gatherer societies are engaged in some other economic activities other than hunting and gathering, such as some of them exchange minor forest products with the local villagers, or some of them engage themselves in the fields of the neighboring villages of the fields of the farmers. They employ themselves as the paid laborers. And in this way, they used to earn food. They used to do the hunting gathering. At the same time, they used to exchange their forest products with the local villagers. For example, they exchange honey. They used to give honey to the local villagers and used to take some well from the local villagers in return. This is a kind of business. They used to engage themselves in the fields of the neighboring farmers as paid laborers. These are done nowadays by the hunter-gatherer societies along with hunting and gathering occupation. Their conditions are not similar to the early hunter-gatherer societies. But when the early men survived, at that time everybody was in a stage of hunting and gathering. Nobody was there doing farming, or the civilized peoples were not there around their settlements. So this type of business did not exist. So some scholars say that it is the wrong way to observe the modern hunter-gatherer societies and to get idea about the past hunter-gatherer societies. Epilogue. Around 10,000 to 4,500 years ago, people in different parts of the world learned to domesticate certain plants and animals. So in this way, the periods of hunting and gathering gradually passed away. And around 10,000 to 4,500 years ago, the people in different parts of the world gradually learned through a long period of evolution to domesticate certain plants and animals. By this time, the Ice Age, about the Ice Age, perhaps I have told you in my first class, Ice Age was being continued, and now Ice Age also had come to an end about 13,000 years ago, and the climate became favorable for vegetation as the climate became warmer and wetter. In the Ice Age, the climate was not favorable for vegetation or growing plants or cultivation because it was too cold, and the world was covered with ice. There was no rainfall at all. It was the dry atmosphere. So in that situation, it was not favorable for agriculture or vegetation. Now the climate had become favorable. The climate had become warmer, there started raining, and then the atmosphere became favorable for vegetation. The grasses like wild wheat and barley began to grow much all over the world. As the grassy land increased, naturally the animals like goat, sheep, pig, donkey, cattle, etc., who preferred the grassland to live, they survive on grass also, they increased in number. These are usually hunted by the early man. Human societies began to choose those areas for longer settlements where wild grass and grass-eating animals were more available. Now, human societies, they started to choose such areas for longer settlement. They had the nomadic habit. They used to shift their settlements from one place to another. But nowadays, in the changed atmosphere, they started to select some areas for longer settlements, because in those areas, wild grasses were more and grass-eating animals were more available. This led to the tendency of permanent settlement. They preferred to live in these areas for a longer time, and it developed a tendency of permanent settlement. It, on the other hand, increased population. Whenever they started To settle over a certain area for a longer time, naturally it increased the size of the population, because when they shifted from one place to another place, all the very old people from their group or some children, they could not sustain the strain of shifting and they used to die. Now, these type of deaths stopped and there took place the increase of population. Human societies began to gather knowledge about wild grasses. For example, wheat and barley, the seeds of which they used to take it as food. Now, human societies used to take the seeds from some grasses, for example, wheat and barley. These, the plants of wheat and barley are a type of grass. Even the plant of rice is also a type of grass. So they used to take the, these were grown wildly, and they used to take the seeds of those plants of wheat and barley, and they began to gather knowledge about these grasses, and they found that these grasses, which are wildly grown, how they are grown from the seeds, again new plants grow up, this type of knowledge they gathered. They started domesticating plants. They started cultivating these wheats and barley. Similarly, after studying the behavior of some animals, they began to domesticate animals like goat, sheep, cattle, pig, etc. They also observed the behavior of the animals. They found some animals, they can be domesticated. They had such a behavior that if they try, those animals could be domesticated. Then they started domesticating some animals like goat, sheep, cattle, pig, etc. And the supply of food became ensured to them. It no longer remained an uncertain issue. The supply of food became ensured to them through the domestication of plants and animals. Thus, a combination of factors like climate change, population pressure, greater knowledge about certain plants and animals, and their domestication led to a great transformation in their life. By this time, they had started settling down and there started a rapid development in their life. A great transformation came into being. And what factors are responsible for it? The change of climate, the change of the ice age, population pressure, because population growth needed the production, and this developed the domestication of plants and animals, this type of features. Greater knowledge about certain plants and animals. All those features together in a combined way affected a great transformation in their life. Farming and pastoralism thus began for the first time in the Fertile Crescent, extending from the Mediterranean coast to the Zagros Mountain in Iran. And this pastoralism and farming first began in the place which is known as Fertile Crescent in history, and the place corresponds to modern Iraq, extending from to the Mediterranean coast to the Zagros Mountain in Iran. It is also known in history as Mesopotamia also. And in our next theme, we are going to discuss on that. Agriculture was thus started. People started to settle down permanently and began to construct permanent houses with mud, bricks, and even stone. And thus, the human being started its journey towards civilization. So in this picture, in the first one, you can see the Fertile Crescent. The green area which is shown, it is the Fertile Crescent, extending from Mediterranean Sea to the Persian Gulf. Near the Persian Gulf, there is the Zagros Mountain of Iran. And in the next picture, we may see the people, the early men, they had started cultivation with a wooden plow and buffalo to draw the plow, and how the early man had developed a village of their own, and they had developed the field of the paddy and other developments in the respect of constructing houses and all, etc., had taken place. Thus, man had started his journey towards civilization. So, this much for today. And before I conclude, I want to tell you that we had finished theme 1. I mean, the discussion is finished, but your reading has remained to be done. You please go through the entire chapter very thoroughly, and it is needed for answering the short questions. And I hope after this discussion, it will be easier for you to understand the different points that is given in your textbook. Thank you.